passing the torch at the end of our year ceremony where we are rewarded and rewarded for all the hard work that we've done throughout the semester in the Leadership Academy. So attending the workshops, attending the volunteer activities, attending the different events that we have throughout the semester and throughout the year, these are the things that you will be rewarded for. This certificate is a big fancy event. Our goal this year are black, white, and coral. Coral accent. And I look forward to seeing you all there. You should have gotten an email. I hope you all got the email with the invitation. You just click on it, fill it out, submit, and you'll be RSVP. Cool. You can wear all black, all coral, all white. Any mixture of how you want to do it.
Absolutely.
Whatever, you know, makes you happy. Cool. Get ready for Rabia. Have a great workshop, guys.
Arifu, and I'm excited to be back here with you all. Thank you very much to Mr. Lefu. I am a CUNY graduate of City College. I am a former corporate trainer and now a career coach, a self-empowerment coach, dealing specifically the majority of the time with women's development and career paths, but also with college students and helping college students who identify as people of color, understand and stand up authentically in the corporate world or in business if that's where you should so desire to go. That being said, the content that I have for you today is regarding emotional awareness. How many of you have ever heard of emotional intelligence, emotional awareness, any combination of that, and what does that mean?
Did you just say you've not never heard of it?
How many have heard of it? Okay, well, you know it.
But to me, with the emotional intelligence, I kind of break it down. So with the intelligence, I'll be able to know, like, I would have a basic amount of where I'm at right now. So, like, I'm a mess right now. I'm aware of what's to come throughout that emotional stage. When I'm aware of it, I'm acknowledging the fact that I'm in that process. And with the management, it's the coping. It's like, I'm learning that I'm using the gym as one of
as a presenter, it is disconcerting for me to have you on my left rear. Thank you. So, yes, ma'am. I'm sorry. Tell me your name.
Anthony.
Tell me your name.
Grace.
Grace, nice to meet you. You were at the last session as well.
Yes, a session
before. Yes, I recognize your face. Hi.
I decided to put a
And the reason why I say yes and is because the other reason why I decided to create this particular course is because I wanted to give validity or have you understand the validity of your emotional, your heart, power, being stronger than your logic or than your mind. In our society today, in the world today, if you think about it as a state, as a point in time over the eons of humanity, we have slowly but surely gotten further and further away from identifying our heart state and our heart's power, and more into logic, logos, the Spartan view, the calculation, the scientific view, and have only valued that. However, if I stand at you in a way that is hostile and threatening, you don't need your mind to tell you, you don't feel good, right? You're new to New Yorker and you says, back up and you tell me. But just the person in you says, I don't like this. And the first response that you have is a grip of emotion. Whatever emotion it is, there's that clenching here. And then you say, no, you either assert yourself, depending on how assertive you are, or you shrink into yourself because you're not sure what to do with this. But that means you're just processing in your head what your body is saying, I don't like. And so what I want to work on today with you is understanding what it means when your body is saying something and how to use that to stand up authentically for yourself at work, in your relationships, even in your own head. Fair enough?
Yes.
All right, so we're going to, Anthony's actually done a really good job of this, but we're going to understand how emotional intelligence is defined by the Western world, where emotions exist in our body, and lastly, how we can use our internal response to manage our external interactions. Good? Okay, our agenda is going to be intelligence and the impact, emotional centers, drivers, and management. And starting from the emotional intelligence definition, it is the ability to perceive emotion. So howsoever you perceive it as a visual thing, as a physical thing, perceive your emotions, access and generate emotions. So if you need to pull in anger, or fire up your anger, how do you do that? Where is that coming from? To understand your emotions and your emotional breath. So as New Yorkers, most of us operate on two poles, happiness and low-level anger, right? And there's this whole breath of emotion in between that we don't use. And so understand that emotional knowledge, and then to reflectively regulate, to promote our own growth. So by reflectively regulating it, what I mean is, or rather, how I understand that definition is, if I think back on my day, and I say to myself, A, B, or C was an undesired reaction, how can I analyze that situation, think about the breadth of emotion that's available to me, and then work accordingly. Far so good?
Yeah.
So, like you said, self-awareness, knowing the self. I'm actually going to read it from here. Self-regulation, managing the self. Internal motivation is the ability to use your emotion to implement your vision and your goals. Empathy is understanding the other person. And social skills is using what you understand to manage the other person. Now I know that there has to be a question here. So, or maybe it's not a question, maybe it's, yes, please. Or maybe it is a thought. Thoughts. Ladies and gentlemen, this cannot be a one-way conversation because you are in school. That means that you are every day processing and thinking about everything that's being thrown at you. And I'll let you know when it's something that I think you really want to write down. Yes. Tell me your name.
I'm Dalia.
Dalia.
Okay, so.
I'm sorry, Dalia.
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 So, my question is, how do you know when you're really self-aware? Because that's something that isn't you can't easily access that being self-aware. You have to know yourself. So how can you get to the point where you're self-aware? How do you know when you're self-aware?
It is both a function of age, so your maturity level, as well as honesty, right? So children don't realize that they have separateness from their parents only until they get older and older and older. And in your teens, you separate either harshly or not, but there's a strong push to step away from your mother or father to identify yourself, right? So that's your first moment of, I am who I am and I get to be, to find myself in my own way. As you get older and older, and you'll see it more frequently in older people, right? They're like, it's just who I am and I'm not gonna change it, or I can't change it. So you slowly become more and more aware of how you operate and what your default responses are. Hopefully somewhere between 7 and 70, you have a moment of saying, this response, while it has certainly in the past, may be overemphasized or de-emphasized, and I'd like to have something different. Getting to self-awareness is essentially gathering all bits of information that you can get in your arena, and in corporate America, there are a number of battery of tests that you can take, right? So it tells you, oh, what kind of manager are you? What kind of communicator are you? What kind of worker are you? And then in the quasi-spiritual emotional field, there are a number of tests that say, okay, where are you as a in the spectrum of types of people? So are you an emoter? Are you a manifestor generator? Are you a driver? Are you a cheerleader? Literally, those titles that I've given you are from four different tests that I have taken in the course of my life that just show you more and more facets of yourself and definitions.
So you're saying like the Myers-Briggs test?
That's the MBTI, huh?
Yes, that would be like a form of the test.
That's a form of the test, and that's one of the most widely known. It's also one of the longest. But there have been tests done over time that are shorter and shorter and shorter that are all showing you some facet, again, of yourself. Just peeling back another layer.
Do you have to get them in that order, or can it be like your social skills and your self-awareness?
Well, if you think about it, your social skills without self-awareness mean that you're either in some form of manipulator or bully or a bully. If you're not self-aware and you are engaging in social interactions, then you're either bullying people or you're letting them walk all over you, right? Because at no point are you asserting yourself to say, yes, no, this is what I want, and this is not what I want. Make sense? But thank you for both of those.
So I know I said to you in the first place, like, when I was doing along, like, when I told her, like, how can I say it now? So basically, when I told her that, basically, this is like the perfect product to do this. With the social skills like many others, people are going to tell you lying, and you're going to show the difference of who's lying and who's telling the truth.
Okay.
And that's not good on my show.
That's more of your ability to detect and to use your own, not even self-awareness, but your own emotion, your own physical response to know when someone's physical doesn't match their oratory. Right? So I tell you that I like you, but my body is like, yeah, I really like you. I think that you're a great person. And, you know, let's get together sometime. Clearly, those two things don't match. So, who knows what the chakras are?
Chakras.
Yes, the chakras. Yes,
okay.
Root. Mm-hmm. And of your spiritual crowning, if you will, within the Christian faith, right? Everyone depicts their spiritual crowning as a halo. If you see the Buddha, it's more of an all-over glow, right? I don't know how spiritual crowning is depicted in Islam, but I'm pretty sure it's not a halo, right? Yes? Did you ever know? No? The reason why I bring up the chakras is because these two, well, let me define it first. They are centers of electromagnetic energy within your body. The strongest one is your heart. That's the one that you know, both as a physical thing, and that I'm explaining to you is also an energetic center. So the heart is the first organ that's formed in the body, before your brain, before anything else, right? You see the baby, you see the beating heart. That's what they're always looking for. That beating heart has 10 times more electromagnetic strength than the human brain. Now, if you think of the heart as the first organ, the strongest center, if you will, I find when I do my meditation, it is sometimes the hardest chakra to activate. Because as you become older and you become more self-aware, you build protection for yourself around your heart. And I'm talking about your emotional heart, right? That protection both keeps the world out and sometimes even keeps you too tightly in. Those centers are the word chakra is a Sanskrit word, and it comes from ancient Eastern physiology, which is why I brought the heart, philosophy, and religious texts. So literally you can Google it and you'll get a ton of information back. However, the two that we're going to talk about today are the solar plexus, which is right beneath your, literally, it's another physical one if you think about it. If you ever get a, especially the guys, if you get an elbow or a fist to the sternum, that's where your solar plexus is. And then your sacral is if you make a fist and put it right beneath your belly button, that space right there, that's where your sacral chakra is. So if you will, it's your core, right? Well, underneath your heart. It's your core. And most of your chakras live in your torso, trunk of your body. The two that we're talking about today are beneath your chest and right above your pubic bone area. The reason why I bring them up is because when most people think of their emotions, they think of either their brain or their heart. Your emotions, as a function of your, as an output of your chakra, come from down here, from your sacral area. And literally, it's working its way up. And you are speaking, and so let's use that example that I had earlier, right? I stepped into this young lady's personal space in a threatening way, her heart clenches, the emotion could be fear, apprehension, or just straight, I don't know what's going on. But before she processes it to come out of her throat to say, what's happening here? It's working its way up her body. If you think about it that way, then it makes sense as a pathway. If you think about the fact that your heart is the strongest emotion, strongest organ, the first organ and the strongest organ, and you wonder, well, why are your emotions not in your heart, but rather in your root area, right? So right above your root chakra is your sacral, right? Oftentimes, kind of that flows, is like, it's called the whole root area. I honestly don't know. Yes. And that is why it is here. Because when your gut clenches, that's your emotional response. But for some people, they'll say, oh, my stomach got butterflies, or my stomach clenches, or if, at a worst case scenario, I can't use that. That is all a function of those two chakras, those two energy centers. Right? If you think of the fight, flight, or freeze response, yes?
So then how do you control it?
I'll pay you later. See? If you think of the fight, flight, or freeze response, they're coming from here. Right? Are you aware that if you are threatened, you cannot use that? Right? If you either have to run or fight, all of your other bodily functions shut down. Right? We know that as a fact. If we take that information, and now we go to how do we use it, here's your empathy and social skills. Down here in your sacral chakra. Up here in your willpower, in your self-directiveness, is your self-awareness, your self-regulation, and your internal motivation. Okay, so of our solar plexus as the chakra that is driving literally willpower, a little bit of logic, and personality, then your ability to be self-aware, to self-regulate your emotions, and to internally drive yourself towards a goal, come from your gut. So to answer your question about how do you, what?
Control.
How do you control what? Specifically.
That butterfly begins, not being trained with butterfly.
Not being able to move. That's one of those things, what's the small brain called? The reptilian brain? I know it as a reptilian brain, I never remember the actual name. But you know how you have our thinking brain, and then the first brain that happens after our heart is formed?
The frontal lobe?
Huh?
The frontal lobe?
No, the frontal lobe is one of the last. This is in the back. Occipital lobe? I thought that was your eyes. Either way, you guys are students. You can Google it, like he said. But to answer the question, if you take your, when your physical body is threatened, it's literally training to say, I'm not going to respond in the way that my reptilian animalistic self would respond. So that's not even a function of your emotions. That's a function of, are you threatened? Right? That there's no emotion to, well, there is. There's fear or anger, which is flight or fright. But both of those are coming from this part of you that says, okay, we're down to basics, and here's how I'm addressing it. However, if we think of our solar plexus, again, as our willpower point, and we say to ourselves, when I want to move towards a goal, when I want to calm myself down, when I want to engage in a fight, I'm going to either take deep breaths, I'm going to hyperventilate, or I'm just going to be still. It's really that simple. Think about it. You see someone engaging in a fight, right? They're speeding up their breath, they're shutting down their organs, they're sucking it all in to output. Trump. If you are engaged in meditation and you really want to calm your heart, you take a deep breath for 8 counts, you suck it in, fill it into your lungs, you fill it into your belly center, and you let it out. That's like, okay, where we're squeezing the balloon all out. If you really wanna, if you wanna jump into a river, right? What do they say? Take a deep breath, go! Just do it. Same thing. Literally, it's the same thing. So now, let's fast forward that, or let's apply that to work, right? Because that's really what we're all here. How do I apply it to a challenging conversation? I'm going to talk to my boss about my hours, right? They're not working for me, I need to change this. I take a deep breath and I center myself. Scan my emotions. What am I feeling, right? Where is it coming from? Excuse me. And how bad am I? Once I know that, now I take myself into a space of deep breath. Okay, we're going to get our goal. Now that I'm deciding to motivate myself, I take another deep breath, hold it, take a forward step, and I'm in that mindset of now I'm going to go and ask that question. But literally, you see how if you just think in terms of what am I feeling, where is it in my body, and what do I want? You've just taken your solar plexus through 3 quick steps. You're like, okay, now I can do it. Right? You're outside a professor's office and it's gonna be a weird conversation, you don't know how it's gonna go. Before you walk in, stop. Even if you're late, because you're already late. Take the deep breath. Let it out. And then go. Changes the whole energy. Yes.
How can I use that when I'm overwhelmed and I know I have a lot of homework to do? I don't know how to start because each one is higher than the other one and I have to do it. Either one's more, the other
If only everything.
We'll talk about that later too. But, well, let's take it from the floor, because I heard somebody on this side saying, I don't know what I heard, but I heard voices on this side. What do you guys think? How would you apply what I just said to, I'm overwhelmed? Hold on one second. Mm-hmm. Yes. Tell me your name.
Try not to think the negative thoughts, like I'm not going to finish or I have so much homework. Just try to focus on basically setting priorities. So if an assignment is due tomorrow, let me finish that one and then I can move on. So like that's it, because you're so confused.
I'm
going to
stop you, Cynthia. You know why? You're in your head right now. We're talking about here. Everybody stand up. How long have you guys been in class?
3 hours.
3 hours?
0.
Okay, haven't been to class yet. Who else? How long? It's 3 o'clock now. How long have you guys been in class so far?
4 hours.
Works. You have a class after you. Okay, let's get the blood flowing. Arms up. Don't be so good, anybody. Take a deep breath while your arms are up. One more. Don't hit anybody! Breathe out. One last one. And hold it. Just hold it. Suck in more air if you can. Suck it in, not into your lungs, into your belly space. Huh? You're about to die. Because you're only breathing up here. You probably haven't even used the bottom half of your lungs. Tie it in. You're a big, strong guy. You can do it. Everybody hands down. We have exponentially increased the carbon dioxide in this room now, so we're going to stay standing for a little bit longer. But to answer her question, the way that you deal with competing drugs, right? So she says, I've got a lot to do, I don't have enough time to do. You started out the right point, which is just center. Pull it all together and let it all out. Do a couple of exercises that literally stretch your torso. Because most of us are walking around like this, or sitting like that. You've got to open up this space. If you can, physically right now, do a back bend. Just tilt back from the hip. You know why you're yawning? Because your body's like, oxygen, yeah! That means you've been tired a long time ago. Mm-hmm. You see these black spots on my eye?
Yeah, that makes two of us.
So I get it. Opening up this space allows you to get the oxygen in, right? Now, in terms of competing priorities within a single window of time, oftentimes all that you need is just the ability to say, what do I want to do? Not what do I have to do, what do I want to do?
Can you get that one?
Right? Because the thing about procrastination, which is kind of where you were going with that, is you don't want to do this thing. So, as someone tutored me, put it down and let it go. Literally step back from it. There are other things that you can do that will make you feel accomplished, even if you don't think that young. However, what the trick is, two things. Making the procrastination your ally. Right, that's what I said. I was like, what? When did I do that? Right, wow, like, huh?
The way you should think the way.
But you can. Because procrastination causes fear. Right? You're like, overwhelmed. And that starts to make all of this tight. You're like, oh my God, I don't know what I'm doing. And then, if you willingly say, breathe out, I will figure it out, I will get it done, because I always do, or some version thereof, then you're just putting it down. If for whatever reason, like, let's say for example today, I've known about this presentation since I have a hard stop deadline. There is no shifting this back. So technically, my drop dead time to start, print, deliver, if this is at 3:30, my drop dead time would be what? In your world.
Immediately.
No, it's to create it, print it, and deliver it. Starts at 3:30. What is your drop dead time? Like,
at least
2 days. Is. Okay. Why? Do you know the material?
Yeah.
Okay. So you don't have to practice. What's the next thing? You see what I mean?
Yeah.
Because now you said it doesn't matter if I don't practice. You might have my material. So again, what's the drop dead time? Take your time. Okay, done. And you'll get it done. Because now you've made it such where you're saying, clearly, this is causing me anxiety. The anxiety is either, I don't know my material, which obviously you do, I don't have enough time, because there are preceding priorities that have earlier drop dead time, and I know that I will get it done. Because there's no option for me not to. I can't put this off, right? It's not a paper. Some things you can. The reason and the way that you make it your ally is that then you say, everything else that I'm doing before this, what information is it giving me for this? See? So literally, go ahead.
Can you elaborate
on that? Wait, everybody sit down. So I have done versions of this presentation for about a year now. This is the first time that I've added the chakra work into it. Why did I add the chakra work into it? Because I went to a workshop 2 days ago and we were talking about chakras, and someone said to me, what about the root chakra? And I was like, it's in another business that I do. I create flower essences, and the essences can be attached to the chakra, right? So I said to myself, okay, let's talk, da 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 da. And then it occurred to me, if your emotional intelligence, if your emotions are derived from a particular chakra, and I'm doing a talk on emotional intelligence, then why would I not incorporate that? I know the material. I'm saying I have the wherewithal, the personal willpower and power, agency, to take what I know from someplace else, go against the grain of corporate speak about emotional intelligence, because you guys can Google all that. You don't need me to tell you that. What you need me to do is to link certain things that you hadn't thought of together. That's where I'm adding value for you. And because I did bits, I did pieces, I kind of thought about this, I kind of thought about that, but as Carlos will tell you, I didn't get him the slides in enough time, but I was able to use information that I just turned on in what I needed to do today. So I use it as my ally. Does that make sense? A little bit. Thoughts? Everybody's kind of like, you're that crazy, and there's no way that's going to work.
I tried to break it down.
There are any number of coping strategies.
New information is coming on the exact subject.
Exactly.
This is what the direction
that I want to take is. Exactly. Nicely done. But that's the point.
Because, okay, another concept is like, they say that the open universe is energy, it's flow. And if once you open it, it will come to you to have you receptive at this time.
Yes. So you are receiving rather than pulling. Just hands open. Just all goes in. Exactly. Yes,
for me, I feel like the conversation would be a plus too, because I can figure out how to get, like, how to stop. And so I usually put a certain amount of time playing the game, which is not good. But then, like, time is on my side, I figure out how to get my favorite time to finish the It used to take like 6 hours to get a 5-day fit run, like now we're doing it 2 to 1 hour.
Mm-hmm. How, so what awareness have you gained from the video game that you played to add to the paper that you had to write?
It like, when I'm thinking like, it had, you know, what can I do? Like, I know like, the video game has nothing to do with my paper, but it gave me, I did like, it gave me time to call the mentor.
Because there's a part of you that's not even necessarily thinking about the game. There's a part of your brain that's able to say, okay, I'm relaxing, but I'm making connections. And those connections are the ones that I want to incorporate into my paper. That is what I mean by making your procrastination your ally. And then after a while, it becomes your friend. And your friend never leaves you behind. Your friend is like, hey, so I thought about that other thing. You want to go write that down and maybe just put it to the side? And then before you know it, you've got a stack of things, and all you have to do is tie them all together. Right? But that is owning the fact that you determine your time and your energy. And when you have done your breathing exercises in the morning, or if you have a meditation practice, you've done your meditation in the morning, and you fire that up, you'd be surprised how things flow.
I've started
doing
meditation, but
lately I've done sleep. Okay. Well, obviously your body wants that. See, the great,
is that the wrong way?
There is no wrong way of meditating. Meditation is a practice, right? We practice being human every day. And most of us get that somehow botched up. When I meditate, I like to